Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Good morning and welcome to this service of worship at Duke University Chapel. We delight to join together in worshiping Christ this morning. So whether you're present in the building, joining us online, or listening on the radio, it is good to worship together today. We pray that this service, you will be moved by Christ's Spirit and drawn deeper into the life of God together. I hope that you'll spend some time today reviewing your worship guide for ways to connect beyond this Sunday morning service with the life and work of the chapel. There are opportunities for fellowship, education, and service. So whether you want to sing in the choir, like next week when you can come and sing with the summer choir, or be part of the education, which like the Sunday morning Bible studies, or join in service, like serve at Urban Ministries of Durham, we hope that you will find a place to be connected. This morning, it's a joy to welcome our young guest preacher, the Reverend Dr. Eric Barreto. He's an associate professor of New Testament at Princeton Theological Seminary, and Dr. Barreto has authored several books, including one of his most recently published ones entitled Exploring the Bible. We look forward to the word that the Lord has given you to share with us today. Thank you for being here today, Dr. Barreto. Psalm 29 begins, "Ascribe to the Lord, O heavenly beings. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory of God's name. Worship the Lord in holy splendor." Let us rise as we are able to worship the Lord together today.
Thank you. We confess our sins that we might be in right relationship with God. Our confession reminds us of God's grace and ever-present work in the world, even as we have sinned. Let us now confess together. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned in word and deed, by what we have done and what we have left undone. We have withheld our treasures, been slow to welcome those we see as outsiders, resisted your transformation, and refused the leading of your Spirit. We repent and turn to you for the sake of the Holy and Righteous One, your Son Jesus. Have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and renew us by your Spirit. Amen. In Christ we are forgiven. Glory be to God. And as a forgiven and reconciled people, let us now pass the peace. May the peace of Christ be with you. Paz de Cristo. Peace, y'all.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination printed in your worship guide. God of compassion, send your Holy Spirit and pour into our hearts that most excellent gift of love as we hear your holy word. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The first lesson is from Psalm 29. Ascribe to the Lord, O heavenly beings, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory of his name. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders, the Lord over mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon. He makes Lebanon skip like a calf and Siron like a young wild ox. The voice of the Lord flashes forth flames of fire. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord causes the oaks to whirl and strips the forest bare. And in his temple, all say, glory. The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord sits enthroned as King forever. May the Lord give strength to his people. May the Lord bless his people with peace. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The second lesson is from Acts, the 10th chapter. Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. The message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please rise as you are able for the reading of the gospel. The gospel lesson is from Luke, the 7th chapter. After Jesus had finished all his sayings in the hearing of the people, he entered Capernaum. A centurion there had a slave whom he valued highly and who was ill and close to death. When he heard about Jesus, he sent some Jewish elders to him, asking him to come and heal his slave. When they came to Jesus, they appealed to him earnestly, saying, "He is worthy of having you do this for him, for he loves our people, and it is he who built our synagogue for us." and Jesus went with them. But when he was not too far from the house, the centurion sent friends to say to him, "Lord, do not trouble yourself, for I am not worthy to have you come under my roof. Therefore, I did not presume to come to you, but only speak the word, and let my servant be healed. For I am also a man set under authority, with soldiers under me, and I say to one, 'Go,' and he goes, and to another, 'Come,' and he comes, and to my slave, 'Do this,' and the slave does it." When Jesus heard this, he was amazed at him, and turning to the crowd that followed him, he said, "I tell you, not even in Israel have I found such faith." When those who had been sent returned to the house, they found the slave in good health. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May be seated. My friends, do you ever wonder what God's voice sounds like? Do you ever wonder if you would recognize God's voice if God whispered in your ear or thundered from a mountain? I mean, we confess week after week that the scriptures are God's word, but what voice do you hear when we together declare the word of the Lord? For some of us, I'm sure, God's voice would sound resonant, deep, something like James Earl Jones with the CNN version more than Star Wars. "This is CNN, not Luke. I am your father." Oh, spoiler alert. For some of us, I'm sure God's voice is gentle, soothing. It's that whisper we have heard when we were scared, worried, hurt by those we loved most. For some of us, I'm sure, we are not sure what God's voice would even sound like. I mean, does God have a voice? A mouth, lips, a tongue? Some of us think this is all very silly. Some of us grew up in churches where God's voice was full of judgment and threat. Turn or burn, obey God or else. God's voice was like the angry preacher on television or on the soapbox on a street corner. Some of us grew up in churches where God's voice felt timid, halting, uncertain. God has some nice words to share with us, but such a God isn't going to change us. Not really. God's voice was like a Hallmark card. Placid, saccharine, momentary. All this might make me wonder how we would know God's voice in the first place if we were to hear it. Not only that, but let's be honest, we have a hard time listening to and for God's voice because life can be so loud, so distracting that we can easily miss when God is speaking. Even worse is that sometimes, oftentimes, we miss God's voice entirely because we don't have the imagination to hear God's voice. Our expectations about what God might say are too restricted. Our expectations about how God would sound are too narrow. Our expectations about what God might say is not open enough to receive the breadth and the depth of God's graciousness. And fortunately, my friends, we are not alone in these problems. In Acts 10, Peter wrestles with God's voice, especially when God's voice seems to lead down an unbelievable path. Before the passage we heard this morning, we meet a righteous centurion named Cornelius. And Cornelius has a vision. A voice in the vision calls Cornelius to send for Peter, and Cornelius listens right away. The next day, Peter has his own vision. In this vision, a blanket comes down from the heavens with all kinds of animals. Three times a voice says, "Kill and eat," and three times Peter refuses to do so. And three times The voice tells Peter that what God has called clean, acceptable, we no longer get to call unclean. All this happens three times, and yet Peter emerges from the vision utterly confused. It is at this moment that Cornelius' men show up, and Peter goes with them, but you can sense some uncertainty in Peter. Is this really what God would want me to do? Can I trust that it actually was God's voice that this Cornelius, this Roman centurion, this Gentile heard? And though he hesitates, Peter comes to Cornelius' house. Though he's uncertain, Peter follows the strange voice. Though he sees all sorts of problems with where he is going, he dares to believe that God just might be speaking. Our passage this morning is when it all clicks for Peter. He finally gets it. He's much less confused, finally. You see, the vision Peter had, a vision about animals and food, was not about what he should eat, but about with whom he should eat. The vision was not about food. It was about people. It was about belonging. And if God has called a people clean, then we have lost the right to call those people unclean or rejected. God's voice has been clear, crystal clear. But notice something in the passage we just heard. Peter gets it, yes. He begins by saying, I now understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who does what is right is acceptable to God. He gets it, finally. But I think he's still a little bit nervous. And you know how I know this? Because I don't know if you noticed, but he just keeps preaching. And you see, when I get nervous, I'm kind of like Peter too. When I get nervous, I just start preaching and preaching and preaching, which is why we might be here all day. So right after our passage in verse 44 is one of my favorite verses in the book of Acts. Go back and take a look at it. Notice what the Spirit does. Look at verse 44. Verse 44 reads, while Peter was still speaking, the Holy Spirit fell upon all who heard the word. While Peter was still speaking, while Peter was still preaching, still unsure about what was happening before him, still uncertain that he had actually heard God's voice, the Spirit says, okay, enough, Peter. Enough with your uncertainty. Enough with your preaching. Enough. And the Spirit falls upon all those gathered in Cornelius' house. Not just righteous Cornelius and his righteous family, but all his close friends he had invited over. You see, in Acts, the Spirit does not wait for us to be ready. The Spirit moves far ahead of us, surprising us at every turn. The Spirit falls wherever the Spirit chooses. And so the Spirit falls, but still, some are unconvinced. Acts tells us that Peter's companions are astounded that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles. Astounded? Really? Here I just get incredibly frustrated with Peter and his companions. I mean, were you not paying attention? Were you not listening? Did you not do the reading for class? I mean, when Jesus calls the disciples at the beginning of Acts to go to the ends of the earth, who did you expect to find out there except a bunch of Gentiles? Weren't you listening? And when Mary and Simeon at the beginning of the Gospel of Luke are singing like they were on the set of Glee or on a Broadway stage, didn't you listen to their resonant songs? Didn't you hear when Simeon saw Jesus as a light to the Gentiles? How did you miss it? Or when Isaiah prophesied that all the nations would gather together on the mountain of God to worship the one true God, or that Abraham was to be a blessing to the nations, or when God created the world, the whole world, and declared it all good, I mean, honestly, were you not paying attention? I want to be so angry at Peter and his companions for not seeing the obvious, for being so resistant, so obtuse. But I can't. Not really. Not if I'm being honest. You see, when God's grace falls upon people I don't think they deserve, I don't think deserve it, I get frustrated too. When God opens God's arms to those who haven't earned it, I sometimes wonder what God is doing. When God is generous and merciful and loving among people who are nothing like me in my communities, I get more than a little anxious. Why? Because if we are honest, God's grace, God's justice is strange to us. God's grace, God's justice baffle us. God's grace, God's justice is confounding because it breaks every rule we thought we knew, every measure of worth we have been taught, every boundary we have inherited and tried so hard to keep. The waters of baptism and the belonging they nurture are not ours. The waters of baptism and that belonging don't belong to us. The waters belong to God and God alone. And these waters, my friends, are abundant. These waters splash over the aqueducts we try to build to concentrate them in one place. These waters exceed the reserves we use to hold on to them for as long as possible. These waters fulfill every thirst. These waters cleanse every wound. These waters refresh every soul. These waters draw us together. These waters make us one. But these waters belong to God and to God alone. And God will send these waters wherever God will choose. For God is in the business of subverting our expectations, even our most deeply held convictions. So do you hear? Listen. Really listen. Close your eyes for a moment and just listen. Did you hear it? Did you hear what the voice of God sounds like? It's not always a booming voice. It's not always a burning bush. Sometimes God's voice is a river of water bubbling softly. God's voice is so often subtle, quiet. We have to incline ourselves to hear it. We have to sink into the world to hear it. And when God speaks, God does not just speak my language, words with which I'm familiar. God speaks in all the languages of the world and even in words we cannot fathom. God speaks in strange ways, but in ways that the Spirit opens us up to understand. Because God is yet, yes, mysterious, but God is present among us. Yes, sometimes God's words are strange in our ears, but the Spirit is a gentle tutor. Yes, sometimes God's words are surprising and strange and shocking, but they are always words of resurrection life. My friends, I don't know what God's voice sounds like, at least not all the time. I don't know what you hear when you hear God's voice. But I know I have heard God's voice, and I know you have heard God's voice. And God's voice contains multitudes. I have heard God's voice when I tasted the food my grandmothers made. I have heard God's voice when my pastor saw gifts for ministry in an awkward teenager. I have heard God's voice when I was serving as a hospital chaplain to a young Latinx couple who had just lost a pregnancy. I heard God's voice when words in Spanish I thought I had forgotten spilled from my lips as I prayed for comfort and hope and grief. I have heard God's voice on the lips of nonverbal people. I have heard God's voice in the protest cries of the oppressed. I have heard God's voice in the joyful cry of a child. I have heard God's voice in the quiet of the night. I have heard God's voice in the tumult of everyday life. And God's voice has always had a different sound, a different tenor. But what has always been consistent, what has always been characteristic of God's voice is one thing, one transformative thing, one thing that I think makes all the difference. God's voice is always a surprise, because God's grace is always more expansive than I had imagined. God's voice is always a surprise, because God's righteousness is always more generous than I had thought. God's voice is always a surprise, because God's justice is always more merciful than I could have ever thought or hoped. The book of Acts does not tell us exactly what God's voice sounds like, but Acts does tell us to listen carefully, to expect the unexpected, to hope against hope, because God's voice is always, always, always a delightful, grace-filled surprise. So listen, my friends, listen. God is speaking.
Thank you.
please share this affirmation of faith with me. We believe that God shows no partiality, and that those who fear God and do what is right are acceptable to God. We believe that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, and that Jesus went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed. We believe that Jesus was put to death by hanging on a tree, but that God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear to those who were chosen by God as witnesses. We believe Jesus is the Lord of all and is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead, and that all the prophets have testified about Jesus, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. You may be seated. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Holy One, whose embrace is wide, you hold us when we do not know how to proceed. You give us provision and comfort when we are weary and scared. As people around the world today wake with war, toil and turmoil, or fall asleep to sedition, we ask that you open your arms, making space for each of us and holding this world within your grace. In the face of violence, Lord God, make peace. In the hearts of those corrupted by greed and fear, make peace. In all of our hearts and actions, make peace. Your peace defies our understanding, and we need you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of us all, even when we are bent upon destruction and division, you seek to unite us. For those of us who are dehumanized, and for those of us who dehumanize others, help us to see your image in us all. Help us to recognize one another as relatives, and help us to find our way out of the maze that our hatred and fear have created. For those of us who are vulnerable to the whims of earthly powers, through identity or health, through citizenship or economic status, through access or lack of access, we ask that you intercede on behalf of all people, making a way when the way seems lost. You are faithful always. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, who heals the sick and lifts up the least of these, we ask that you turn your face to our most vulnerable, to the sick and grieving, to our neighbors and those among us who do not have enough to eat, enough for rent, enough to survive. We ask that you turn your face to those who never see and those who are we never see and those who are made invisible by society. You are all seeing, O Lord. We ask that you comfort the lost, the forgotten, the hungry, and the grieving. We ask that you liberate us from systems that provide for some while neglecting and oppressing others. Most of all, we ask for healing of all kinds for our church, our city, and the people of the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We faithfully turn to you, Lord, who embraces us and listens to our pleas. Speak into our lives. These things we ask, knowing you will answer, in your holy and precious name. Amen. All of today's cash offerings and checks written to Duke University Chapel will be used in support of the Development Fund for Mission and Ministry. Let us give cheerfully of our resources, reflecting God's generosity and in our love for our neighbor.
You surprise us with your goodness, God of grace and glory, and welcome us with open arms. We thank you for your goodness and your active presence in our lives, which we do not deserve. We praise you for how you've shown up for us, corporately and individually, time and again opening paths of restoration and reconciliation and freedom. On this holiday weekend, we bless you even as we remember that our life, freedom, and hope are found in you. Open the paths of freedom for all, life for all, and hope for all. Speak to us again and again your word of grace and truth, that we might join all creation and all people in your praise. We thank you for the abundant waters of your love. May we be consumed by your waters and filled with your Spirit. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. May the God who surprises us with the wideness of God's grace bless and keep you and ever draw you deeper into the waters of the Spirit. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.